All right, so we're on week three, so in Isaiah chapter five. So there's, so I like to start out. Did anybody have wonderful things that they liked, or questions that they have? Not that we have all the answers, but we can write them down.
Well, I like that poem. I like that poem.
What I thought was, I kept thinking of you, thinking about how you really probably like this week because of all the poetry and the ways to communicate. And being an engineer, I kept thinking, I wish God spoke more with science than it did with poetry.
So a little more straightforward.
It would be easier for me. Yeah. So I realized that it's more challenging for me. So
yeah, and Hebrew poetry is different than how I write. I mean, it's repetition of, you know, a phrase and then another phrase that means the same thing but is slightly different. You know, that's. And as they share too, sometimes the words are real similar, you know, they don't rhyme necessarily, but they're similar for you to try to pay attention for people, you know, and she'll share it too, like this is for listening. The prophet is speaking, is they're supposed to be listening, not just the writing part. So as they hear those words that are similar, paying attention, you know, getting the same different, I don't know, but yeah, repeating the same message, and lots of the scriptures have that, you know, here's a line, here's another line that has the same meaning, slightly different words. So pay attention. It's really important. What I'm saying is really important. So sharing that. So yeah, the prophet as poet. Yeah. All right, any others?
I guess for me, I like poetry that rhymes, and you don't really find that much in Hebrew poetry. But a lot of times, if you could read it in Hebrew, you would find that it's much closer to rhyming than it is in English, but it just doesn't translate.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we look at it and say, well, is this really even poetry? Because isn't it supposed to rhyme? So for me, I struggle a little bit with Hebrew poetry as well, but if we all could read Hebrew, it'd probably be easier.
Well, it's not easy to speak.
No,
<but.
laughs>
I took one semester. It's not easy. Need a lot more semester than that.
That's just enough to know that you don't know anything. Yeah. And to prove it.
So, go ahead.
We weren't on when we talked about next week.
Okay, yeah,
so
go ahead.
Can we go ahead and talk about this? This is the book for the study next week. I know that's very clear up there on that tiny little screen, but the name of the book is Journey to the Resurrection, and it's a six-week Bible study that will be starting next week on Ash Wednesday, which is February 14th. And we all know that Ash Wednesday is the most important part of February 14th. That other commercial holiday doesn't exist. But anyway, this six-week study, the books are available now. And for next week, I'd like you to take a look at Lesson 1. Session 1, it's the first week study. Read through it, look up the scriptures if you like, and look at some of the questions, and it'll help you get an idea of what the course is going to be like. You're certainly welcome to participate. The books are available both at Trinity and Grace. And so we'll start that, and that will run until April 3rd, as I had my lesson earlier. April 3rd, and then, or actually it'll run till Easter, and then on April 3rd, we'll do start session 4 of Isaiah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's pray.
Okay.
Gracious God, as we continue to learn from the prophet Isaiah, as we continue to learn from your word, we thank you so much for the many blessings you give us. And we pray for all those that are facing many challenges. At Grace and Trinity, have had loved ones that have gone to be with you. But the families and the concerns that they have, the comfort and peace that they need, we just lift them all up to you. And we thank you as we continue to grow and to learn that we don't just say that's what Isaiah shares, that's what the word shares, and somebody else needs to hear. May we learn what we need to hear, how we need to grow, how we need to continue to focus on you and how your holy ways. So we thank you so much for the many ways that we can continue to see your presence and your peace, your strength, your wisdom, your holiness, and to follow you. As we study about Israel, we can point the finger at them and see what is wrong. Help us to understand how we need to grow and change and the things that we need to learn from all of this. So we thank you that you continue to give us an opportunity to grow and be holy like Jesus, to learn from them. And so we praise you for this time. Be with those who are unable to come tonight and ask a peace and strength. May your word continue to speak to all of our hearts in powerful ways. And we praise you for the ways you will continue to guide us and strengthen us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. So we'll get to watch the video and share. She's got lots of things that she's sharing. I encourage people to take notes, whether you take notes in your book or on your paper. And then if you have questions and stuff too. And then we'll go over some of the things that are in the book. And if you were able to do the assignments, going over those processes and too. But she'll be reading Isaiah chapter 5, the first part. So we'll get to hear her read that as well.
Hey everyone, welcome back. This session, we are dealing with the prophet as poet and rhetorician. And when we start diving into the concept of poetry and rhetoric, what we're really diving into is the question of genre. And I wind up telling my seminarians this all the time, that when it comes to biblical interpretation, one of the primary critical questions you have to ask before you do anything else is what sort of genre am I dealing with? Am I reading the instruction guide to my new DVD player, or am I reading a letter from my mom while I'm in college? Am I reading a sonnet, or am I reading a history book? And of course, the content that you are going to derive is going to be vastly different if it's an instruction manual or if it's a textbook. So if you, the reader, don't know what sort of genre you're dealing with, your likelihood of misinterpreting what you're reading is escalated beyond measure. So we're talking about the question of genre, and talking about question about genre, we are asking the question of what genre are the biblical prophets? So one of the things you need to know is that most of the oracles that you are bumping into the book of Isaiah were intended to be heard, not read. And there really is a vast difference between a presentation that was intended to be heard and a presentation that was intended to be read. I know, because on a regular basis, I present oral lectures that I then have to transfer into some sort of article format so that they can get published in a journal. And let me tell you, the process of going from oral to written is miserable. And the process of going the other direction for me actually is a little easier, but for other people is miserable. So keep in mind that your prophets are presenting to you primarily in a genre that was intended to be heard, not necessarily read. And because of that, when I teach the book of Isaiah, I actually set up my students to have reading partners so that as they read through the book, one student is reading an oracle to the other student. And the very interesting exchange that takes place is the one who is listening without looking hears things that they never heard before. And if you happen to be a public speaker yourself, you understand that repetition is important, that assonance is important, that rhythm is important, and often you will wind up making the same point two or three times, where that would be laborious in a written presentation. It's essential in an oral presentation. So again, our prophets are intending to be heard, not necessarily to be read. Granted, by the time this material winds up in your canonical book of Isaiah, someone has cleaned it up some, but I challenge you to listen as much as you read. So let's talk about the art of public speaking. It is actually known as a discipline with the term rhetoric. Now, often when we hear the word rhetoric, we're hearing someone criticize a politician, right? And they're saying, oh, there was no substance. It was just all rhetoric, right? And we have sometimes a negative connotation that goes with the word. But in reality, rhetoric is a discipline, and it's the discipline of communication, effective communication, effective oral communication.
If anyone wants to write any of that down.
And rhetoric has an actual formula for success. According to Aristotle, that formula involves ethos, pathos, and logos. You can hear the Greek of Aristotle's background in that presentation. So, effective rhetoric involves ethos. What's that? It's the perceived credibility of the speaker.
So if we ask someone who we don't consider very credible, do we stop listening?
Yep.
Or yes, not pay attention as much?
Or you,
so,
oh, sorry.
Or you argue with them in your mind.
That's true, and we do that a lot, don't we? We hear somebody talking and we don't agree with them, so we're going through our mind instead of listening to see what they're really saying. We're in our mind deciding how everything that they're saying is wrong. So I guess.
No, we don't do that.
You're right.
Well, for example, when Suzanne Somers gets up on an infomercial and tells you that the hormones she's taking are making her beautiful and healthy, you watch that info commercial and you go, But if the president of the Pediatric Association of America stands up in an oral presentation and tells you that giving hormones to emerging adolescents is probably going to create later sterility in life, you're like, whoa, maybe I should pay attention to that. So ethos is important, perceived credibility. Pathos is emotional appeal. You can say some really amazing stuff, and if you don't inflect any
so does the math and science and engineer want to do the first one, not the second one? So.
Actually, as I read the, as I was reading the lesson, I do have interest in public speaking and how to be a good communicator from a sales standpoint and
yeah.
From a leadership standpoint. And so I thought all of this, I knew all of this, but I never thought to digest all of it and break it down. So I thought this part was pretty interesting, actually.
Yeah, that is a good point.
Level of emotional investment in your material, you know what? Neither will your audience. So emotional appeal is important, humor and heart. In fact, I've done a fair amount of reading on what it takes to make an effective public speaker, because I kind of sort of do that for a living. And one of the most famous speakers of all time, you know what he had to say about an effective presentation? Rehearse, 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 and be funny. That's it. There's your college education in communications. All right. So pathos is important. Humor and heart. Creating an emotional climate conducive to the goal that I'm after. And then the last element of effective rhetoric is logos, content. You can be funny, you can be fun, you can have great credibility, but if you don't have any content, all right, you might be a nice flash in the pan on the speaking circuit, but eventually you're going to fade into the background. Ethos, pathos, and logos. And of course, since our prophets are public speakers, they need to have all three of these going on. And for the most part, they do have all three of these going on. When it comes to ethos, what type of credibility does a prophet have? Well, we talked about that at length in our study. They are messengers of the divine council. They are officers of the theocracy. They are the diplomat of the high God Yahweh. So they got some ethos going on. Yeah, they do. What about pathos? Well, for our prophets, and especially if you hear them speak, they love their people. They love their people, they love their God, and they love the covenant. And Isaiah will on a regular basis bring you, the reader, to tears, and you will hear the catch in his throat as well. I read through his passages and I am so often slain for the level of investment he has in this ragtag group of people that are called the people of God. So yeah, they got pathos. What about logos? What is their content? Well, it's the covenant itself. These guys are preaching Moses. Isaiah is preaching Deuteronomy. So they got logos as well. Now, in regular rhetoric, typically a speaker is going to succeed, and they will teach you this in your communications class, because that public speaker will effectively analyze and tap into the shared value system that the speaker has with the audience.
Anybody know someone who is really good at doing that? Who knew a lot about their audience and talk to their audience in terms that they understood really well. Gave
Jesus.
Them there you go. Hey. Yeah, because he gave them examples from, you know, their jobs, their culture, the things that they saw, agrarian, used the winery and the, you know, wine and how it's made, use that over and over again. And, you know, if we read carefully in Isaiah, we'll see that Isaiah was very good at that. And Jesus quoted Isaiah a lot. You know, the like in Luke 20, where he's talking about the vineyard is almost directly out of Isaiah. So just.
This is why it's so important to know your audience. If you've ever watched a speaker truly crash and burn, 9 times out of 10, it's because they've misread their audience. They don't have a shared value system. And since they don't have a shared value system, instead of motivating their audience toward action, they wind up repelling their audience. And the audience says, "What an idiot," and walks away. So this business of a shared value system is very important in rhetoric. Well, at Wheaton College, I got to work with a number of folks who are just amazing communicators. And one in particular actually did his dissertation on prophetic rhetoric. And the prophetic rhetoric that he tagged into in his dissertation was the fact that prophets don't operate with the same sort of rhetoric as an American politician. Because whereas an American politician is doing everything they can to tag into that shared value system, and to stay ahead of that shared value system so that they can be reelected next year, even if they don't necessarily accomplish anything. Sorry for my cynical perception. The prophet, who has all the ethos in the world, has all the pathos you could ever ask for, has all the logos anyone could wish for, the prophet cannot adapt his logos to his audience. Yes, he can adapt his medium. Yes, he can adapt his idiom. Yes, he can pull up modern means of communique. He can change his dress code. She can change her presentation. We can adapt our language and our metaphor, but the prophet cannot change their message. And this makes them a very unique rhetorician. It also is the reason that real prophets die. Let's move on to poetry, another aspect of prophetic genre, because prophets actually are making use of poetry in their presentation to their people. Perhaps not the sort of poetry you might expect, but poetry all the same. You see, poetry is defined as high eloquence. And one of my professors at Harvard University, his name was James Kugel, made the argument early on in his career that we have incorrectly divided the biblical text between poetry and prose. And that this really is more of a Greek framework, not a Hebrew framework. And I agree with James Kugel. What he argued is that in regular speech, what typically happens is that someone's form of speech raises with each elevation of the formality of their setting. So you will start off with a, hey dude, how's it hanging? You'll move up to perhaps an email that you would send to your parents. Then you'll go on to an email that you'd send to your professor. Then you'd move up to a letter that you'd send to your employer. And somewhere along the line, you're going to wind up with 47 years ago, our forefathers brought forth upon this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. This is high eloquence. Is it a sonnet yet? No. But it clearly is a formal presentation of elevated speech intended to capture the hearts of its audience. And this sort of high eloquence is not simply on or off, black or white, left or right. It is a progression of a presentation of speech. So this is, according to James Kugel, a complex of heightening effects, used in combinations and intensities that vary widely from composition to composition, even within a single genre. I love this statement, a kind of strangifying that marks the language as special. And as you start listening.
What do you think that means, strangifying? If you always say something one way, people get used to hearing it. But if you can figure out a way to slightly change it, make it a little strange to what you hear, it might trigger something in their mind, might be something that they latch on to.
I like the word unique better than strange, but
unique,
special,
unique-ifying.
So kind of like Yoda in the Star Wars.
Yeah, yeah. That's a reasonable example where, because he says normal things in an abnormal way. Well, you probably don't like normal and abnormal. He says normal things in a unique way.
Into the way that you speak and write and interact when you go to church versus the way you interact when you go to the audience, go to the office, you're going to hear this sort of higher elevated speech in your own practice. Well, you're also going to find it in the book of Isaiah. You're going to find word plays and reversing syntax and metaphor and rhythm and even some rhyme as you move into your prophets. So asking the question, what is poetry? It is a strangifying of regular speech. Let me give you a few examples. The fog comes in on little cat feet. It sits looking over the harbor and city on silent haunches and then moves on. If you have ever sat on a dock in the state of Maine in the morning, you have watched the fog come in on little cat feet. This strangifying is not necessarily rhyme, but it brings us into a level of emotional engagement with the language that is beyond, hey mom, it's foggy this morning. Or how about we move on to another famous poem, this one by Emily Dickinson. Because I could not stop for death, he kindly stopped for me. The carriage held but just ourselves and immortality. We slowly drove, he knew no haste, and I had put away my labor and my leisure too for his civility. It had to rhyme. If you know Dickinson well, you know that this poem is going to go on to describe someone who has already died and doesn't realize that they are dead. And in this sort of poetry, again, we are captured by the author's presentation. Or perhaps you're a Billy Joel kind of guy or gal like I am. And you remember these lyrics, in the middle of the night, I go walking in my sleep from the mountains of faith to a river so deep. I must be looking for something, something sacred I lost, but the river is wide and it's too hard to cross. Yes, I've been searching for something taken out of my soul, something I would never lose, something somebody stole. Guys, poetry is like this. What poetry does and what Isaiah does is it reaches beyond our regular boundaries, our regular barriers. It does it by means of song, it does it by means of rhythm and rhyme, and it breaks through where a regular didactic presentation wouldn't touch. And that's why our prophets are doing it, because it reaches beyond, it sneaks in there, and it changes us. So as you read the book of Isaiah, realize that you are also reading poetry. But the type of poetry you're reading is not necessarily the type of poetry you're used to. This is not roses are red and violets are blue, skunks are stinky, and so are you. Rather, Hebrew poetry, Hebrew eloquence, is going to be based on something that James Kugel named the seconding sentence. Now, if you're a seminary grad yourself, you've probably heard of parallelism. And Kugel was the one who stepped up to the plate and said, hey, you got 17 different types of parallelism. Maybe you haven't identified the basic common denominator here. So instead of parallelism, let's call it the seconding sentence. And once again, I agree with James Kugel. The idea is that Hebrew poetry is based not on rhyme, but it's based on repetition. It's based on short, choppy sentences that restate what has already been stated. So you wind up with a format that says A and, as a matter of fact, B, or A and even more so B, or A and in contrast B. And reality is that our biblical authors play with this format over and over again. And they twist it this way and that way and they overlay it. They strangify it. And they strangify it in so many ways that you can't simply come up with categories of how they do it. Just like any artist, the point is to play and strangify until your audience is caught off balance and you break past their barriers and you change their heart. So this is how Hebrew poetry works. Poetic style in Hebrew is going to involve word pairs and parallel lines. There are going to be refrains and certainly rhythm and alliteration and assonance. There's going to be simile and metaphor, personification, wordplay, punning, all of these things, but not so much rhyme as there's going to be rhythm. And the rhythm is going to be a rhythm of sense, a rhythm of repetition. Let me show you an example that you're going to be working on in your study guides. And the example is the Song of the Vineyard that you find in Isaiah 5. And this is a beautiful example of Isaiah at his best, making use of poetry, making use of song to capture his audience, to draw them in, and then to bonk them on the head is basically where he's headed. So as we look at the Song of the Vineyard, and we're told right up front, it's a song. So we're thinking Billy Joel, we're thinking Hamilton, we're thinking some great hymn of the church that we have come to love. And it reads as follows. Let me sing now a song for my well-beloved, a song of my beloved concerning his vineyard. Have you already heard some of the repetition that the prophet is playing with? We're talking about songs and beloved. And if I could read it to you in Hebrew, which maybe if you come and take intermediate from Hebrew from me, I'll get to do, you'd hear it even louder. But you can see it in your English text as well. My well-beloved had a vineyard on a fertile hill. That's your lead line. He dug it all around. He removed its stones. As you look at the slide, you can see that the repetition of verbal action is being repeated. He dug it all around. He removed its stones. He planted it with the choicest vine. He built a tower in the middle of it. He hewed out a wine vat in it. He then expected it to produce good grapes, is probably what your translation says. I can tell you what it literally says is Sorek grapes, which are a domesticated type of grape that don't grow naturally, but produce way better and have far fewer seeds. Basically, if you're going to be drinking really good grape juice or really good Merlot, you want Sorek, you don't want a wild grape. He expected it to produce cultivated grapes, but instead it produced only wild or worthless ones. So you can see the poetry building. And if you had been sitting in the audience and the great Isaiah had been reciting the song, you would already be captured. He goes on to say, now let me tell you what happened to my vineyard. And he talks about the fact that this vineyard, again, produced only worthless grapes, even after this profound investment. And so the second stanza comes in. So now let me tell you what I'm going to do with my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it will be consumed. I will break down its wall, and it will become trampled ground. Do you hear the repetition of both the verb and the object? And I will lay it waste. It will not be pruned or hoed, but briars and thorns will come up. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? And I will also charge the clouds to rain no rain upon it. Our prophet goes on, and he says, for the vineyard of Yahweh of hosts is the house of Israel. Uh-oh. He's already nabbed his audience. He's already pulled them in. They don't want to hear this. The vineyard of Yahweh's host is the house of Israel and the men of Judah, his delightful plant. Thus he looked for justice, mishpat, but behold, bloodshed instead. He looked for righteousness, and instead, tzedakah, a cry of distress. And so the audience is captured, and the audience is slammed with the message that broke through their barriers because of the poetry that was involved. Let me tell you just a little bit about viticulture in ancient Israel in the time that we have. So as you work on this poem, you can feel the level of effort that stands behind it. And the Bible has many, many references to vineyards. In fact, you'd have to turn, maybe five pages, not have a reference to grapes or wine or vineyards in either the Old or the New Testament. And that's because vineyards and viticulture was such a standard aspect of Israel's economy. They grew grain, they grew grapes, and they grew olives. And over again, especially throughout the book of Deuteronomy, we'll hear that triad describing their economy. Israel's climate and soil was exceptionally well suited to viticulture and the production of grapes, as is the state of California, by the way. And so we know that grapes were growing natively and naturally in this area that we came to call Israel from as far back as 3000 BC. In fact, I'll make the argument to you that the wild grapes that Isaiah is so upset about are the grapes that would have grown there anyway as weeds, except for the vine dresser had gone to such expense and effort to transform that field into something that would hang onto the transplanted and domesticated Sorek grape. As we look at Deuteronomy, we hear that the Lord is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks, of water, of fountains and springs, flowing forth in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive oil and honey. This is how they would have self-understood. So what type of effort went into creating a vineyard? Well, the first thing that happened is that you had to clear the land. And although right now you look at the land of Israel and you think that it has always been pretty much denuded of trees, reality is that when Israel settled, the central hill country was covered with a very thick native evergreen oak forest. And if you've ever tried to get an oak down out of your yard, you have some idea of the effort that went into clearing these fields so that they could grow. And if you've ever done it with a rock axe and had to chop it down yourself, okay. This is getting real here. So what these guys had to do is they had to clear the hills and then they had to maintain the topsoil. And the only way they could hang on to the topsoil on a denuded mountainside is they would terrace the mountainside. So they take all the rocks they collected. And as you look at the screen, you see an image of what terracing in Israel looks like. These little flat platforms of soil in which the farmers could plant. And what they would plant in those flat platforms were, again, grain, and vines and olives. Here is an image actually just outside of Lachish that shows a standard vineyard. The grape harvest would occur somewhere around July and August. Grape clusters would be cut down, they'd be placed in baskets, and with very little delay so that the grapes didn't get bushy or ugly, they'd be taken to wine presses that are actually carved out of the stone. Again, are you thinking about the amount of labor that goes into this? Carving it out of bedrock so that the harvesters could then dump the grapes into these wine presses and design around the wine presses structure so that the harvesters could take off their shoes, wash their feet, and stomp these grapes into wine. And you're taking a look at a drawing here of such a wine press where after the grapes had been crushed and the human feet had moved over the pits so that they weren't crushed and made chewy things in the wine, the actual wine would come out of the evacuation tunnel and land in a vat where it was then jarred and stored, and a clay stopper was put in the top of this wine jar with a little fermentation hole so that the gases could escape. And as a result, we would wind up with the standard beverage of the biblical world. Why did they drink wine more than water? Because once you ferment something, you kill the bacteria. And so even children drink wine in the biblical world. Archaeology bears out all of this detail I'm describing to you. The discovered presses are flat hewn surfaces of bedrock. And of course, we've got wine jars and perforated stoppers aplenty. All right, so that is the effort that Yahweh puts into creating his vineyard. This vineyard that Isaiah is singing about. Everyone in the audience would have known these economic realities. Everyone in the audience would have had a brother, a father, or a grandfather who had worked one way or another in the viticulture industry. In other words, our rhetorician has tapped into a shared value system. Isaiah knows that his audience knows how much effort went into this process and how much expense. So when that vineyard fails to perform, everyone in the crowd realizes that this is an economic disaster. And when they hear at the end of the poem that they themselves are actually the vineyard, well, I can guarantee you that no one is happy with Isaiah when he brings home the parable in this fashion. So let's turn the page to the New Testament. Because in Matthew 21, verse 33 through 46, Jesus does much the same. See, by the time we get to the Gospel of Matthew, everybody has forgotten about the fact that the ancients were mad at Isaiah. And they have recognized that what was predicted in Isaiah chapter 5 is going to result in the exile. But now we've all come back from the exile, right? And now we're way holier than those people who went into exile. We would never make the same stupid mistakes that they made. We are the Pharisees and the Sadducees. We are holy. Yes, we are. And so Jesus picks up this same parable in his telling of the tale. We're in Matthew 21, and he begins to speak to his audience. And he says, "Hear another parable. There was a master of a house who had planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it. At this point, his audience might have been getting a little nervous. And he built a tower and he leased it to the tenants and he went into another country. When the season for the fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. As you know this story, these servants are not treated well at all. They are beaten, they are stoned, they are killed. The master comes back and says, well, I'll send more servants, and surely they'll treat them better than the first. But the same happens to the second set of servants. And so the master finally says, I'll send my heir. I'll send my son. Surely they'll treat him with respect. But the tenants instead said, oh, this is the heir. Let's kill him and have his inheritance. And so they took him and threw him out of the vineyard, and they killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, Jesus turns to his audience, what will he do to these tenants? If you know this chapter of the New Testament well, you know that everyone in the crowd was outraged, in particular the Pharisees and the Sadducees, because the religious leaders realized at this point that Jesus was pulling in the song of the vineyard and that he was confronting them, the religious holy leaders, with the exact same accusations that have been directed at the men of Israel and the tribes of Judah in the oracle of Isaiah. Once again, our rhetorician has succeeded in tapping into a shared value system. But in tapping into that shared value system, he has managed to profoundly offend his audience. Yes, it's true. Poetry and song often get past our boundaries and into our hearts. But as both Isaiah 5 and Matthew 21 demonstrate, sometimes great rhetoric gets us killed.
Sounds fun, huh?
Are you a little worried about preaching Sunday?
It should always be a challenge, and we should always be making sure that it is an amazing, not take it for granted, we just go up and talk. It is God's word we're trying to share, so it should always feel very special and dependent upon God. So, comments from this.
I never put it together that Matthew 21 is talking about Isaiah 5.
What was that?
I never put it together that Matthew 21 was referencing Isaiah 5.
Luke 20 does the same thing. It's in one of the other gospels too. Well, maybe not, but Luke 20 tells the same story, this story from Isaiah.
So does it, in, I was wondering, if you have a book that has the references back and forth, does it share that?
I don't.
Does it share?
I don't think it's in the Bible. I have.
Or mine does. So.
Oh, okay.
So 521 has started right.
Matthew 21.
Thank you. I'm nearsighted, so I can see really good with my eyes.
Sorry.
And close up.
Verse 33.
32. Yep. Isaiah 5, 1 to 7. That's one of the things that's kind of neat about Bibles like this that have you know, the connection between different ones too. So it is listed there. So you know, what other scriptures are connected to this particular one? And then you can also look, this one has a concordance too. So you have different topics. You know, if you want to look at vineyards, it would have different ones there too. So it connects like that. So yeah, it's there. Yeah. And that's one of the things that when we read scripture and stuff too, that's one of the things I do as a sermon. What are some of the references? What are the connections? How does it relate to other scriptures as we look at that to share? Probably like any pastor, we read so many other things, scriptures, comments, references. Well, we don't preach that all, you know, but trying to use that to influence what we do share, the importance of what we do share and stuff too. And so other comments from this? Questions from it too. Maybe you disagree with it.
In the video, she was talking about how the prophets could not change the logos. They couldn't change the content of their message because their message had come from God. And so a lot of times when they would say, "Hear the word of the Lord," when they started to address their audience, and different prophets said different things to identify that the message was coming from God. And we should find ourselves in the same situation when we're talking about the good news of the gospel too, that we don't have the opportunity to change the gospel, the good news that Jesus told us, just so that we can reach our audience. We have to stand true to the message as we receive it, as we find it in scripture. And so I think that's worth pointing out, that we have to be careful with the logos when we are trying to reach our audience. We can change the pathos. We can try to appeal to the people where they are because we understand and we're empathetic to their situation. And we can appeal to the ethos, but we can't change the logos. We have a message. It's not ours.
All right, let's turn to page 30. And while we heard Isaiah 5, 1 through 6, let's hear it again. Get them to go over some of the questions from that as well. So whoever would like to read Isaiah 5, 1 to 6, and it'll be on the screen too, right?
Please join us for our oh.
I see how you are.
The vineyard of the Lord destroyed. Let me sing for my I see how you are. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it. He hewed out a wine vat in it, and he looked for it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I looked for it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. From the sole of my foot, even to the head, there is nothing sound in it, only bruises, welts, and raw wounds, not pressed out or bandaged, nor softened with oil.
All right, so the question, what is it? Who is the singer of this song or poem? Who do you think that is?
Isaiah.
Okay. And who's he singing about?
God.
God.
Anyway.
Did I get that right?
And who's the vineyard people? Because if the vineyard's not doing what's right, who's that?
Israel.
Israel.
Okay. So are vineyards important in Indiana?
Not really.
Does anybody know about Highway 69? And a vineyard.
All Bloomington winery. Oh. There's a few down along there.
they did not. Well, it would have been a perfect line path because the winery, the vineyard there, like whoop. It was not the best, but they didn't. So vineyards are still important. They're still. So have you ever again the as you shared earlier the story started. Talking about a vineyard, something that was important for the community, but that said, this is you. This is, you know, some type of experience like that where, you know, you think, oh, this is just a story. And then, oh, wait a minute. It's a story that affects me more, a story about me, things I need to change. Any kind of experience, anything like that?
Well, and I think we don't necessarily see the importance of a vineyard and the wine like they would,
right,
because that was their primary beverage. So, you know, for us, when we read it, you think, okay, so, you know, big deal. It's not that great. But to them, it would have had a much deeper meaning. It had been more important to them. So to me, when, you know, sometimes when I read this, it doesn't mean as much, or it doesn't maybe affect me because I don't relate to that story or to that connection as much as what it would to the people of that time.
Right. So those who are going to grace don't listen. So what was the first miracle that Jesus did?
Water and wine.
Do we think it's important? Do we think the weddings are that important to have wine for a week? They did. You know, it was a celebration to make sure that they had the hospitality for the whole time. So, you know. Giving that everything. So, yeah, so understanding that. So, again, anybody else grow up on a dairy farm?
I worked on one in the summers.
Not the same. And I'm glad that, you know, some people understand a little bit because, you know, they got at the hay or they did, you know, that. But, you know, whatever your background is, you know, engineer, science, math, you know, whatever's your background and understanding, you know, trying to relate that and understand. So for us to go back to the scripture and say, okay, you know, so if I could compare this. So sometimes that would help to put it in a particular situation to help us. If it was for me, that would be, this was what would be so important, you know, but the message too, though, still is, you know, what Isaiah was telling people, but you're not doing what's right. You are not following God's ways, you know. So we could use a different kind of example of that would affect that, but still understanding the meaning is making sure you're following God's plan for you, God's ways. So Yeah. Anything else on day one that you wrote, commented, or questions there?
I would say if we look back at the video, one of the things that she talked about was the prophet loved the people that they were talking to. And if you look in verse 4 that we just read, what more was there for me to do for my vineyard that I had not done it? You know, the prophet really cared about Israel. And what more could he have done? What more could he have told them that they would have become obedient instead of turning away from the word of God? And so you can hear kind of the anguish of the prophet in there. What else could I do? Might have said something like that to your kids at one time or another.
Well, I was just thinking that too, of parents with children. You ever tell children of what they should be doing or what they shouldn't be doing? And especially if you have more than one, and the one who is, or if you're a teacher, and you're talking to them, and you're trying to get a point, and hoping that the ones who are disobedient, who are not following the ways and rules, hopefully that they will listen. And usually they're the ones that are like, oh, I'm glad you talked about so-and-so. And it's like, it wasn't you. that was supposed to be connecting to, you know. Sometimes they didn't get it, you know. So trying to help have something that will speak to their hearts and get them to follow God's ways and be holy instead. All right, so day two. That's about gardening and plants and vegetables. So, and Isaiah 5, 1 through 7. So, we already read 1 through 6, so verse 7.
And one thing, Roseanne over there, right? Rayanne was talking about not seeing the vineyard as important because the context isn't a context that we can relate to. And that's what she calls again at the beginning into the book. She talks about the great barrier again, because where we are in history and where they were, that's part of the great barrier. And then also part of the great barrier is that we don't live in an agrarian society like they did. And so more of the great barrier, more of the struggle that we have to understand what Isaiah is talking about.
Yeah. Like the crops that they had, grain, now not all the grain that we have, just wheat, barley, and then olives and grapes. I mean, how many of you guys have raised olives?
I'd like to.
Good luck.
Just, you know, other things that are different. So too. So, all right. Verse 7, someone read that, please.
For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant plantings. And he looked for justice, but behold, bloodshed. For righteousness, but behold, an outcry.
All right. So, sharing the message, and then explaining exactly what it means. This was the house of Israel, the people that were supposed to be doing God's word, God's ways. So, are there any other questions or any? Did you write anything else down in day two? Great answers.
Well, question 3, if you were the farmer, what would you have expected based on your investment?
A good crop.
Good fruit.
A good crop. Good fruit. A return on your investment. And so they talk about tearing the hedge down. I will remove its hedge. They would have grown a hedge, a high hedge around it to keep wild animals out of it. So once they tear down the hedge, then the animals are going to destroy the vineyard. So that's what the result of their disobedience is going to be, is the destruction of the vineyard.
page 35. So if we ponder the prophet's words, we need to ask ourselves, is my life actually bearing the sort of fruit that reflects my Christian identity? Now, that's a question we probably really don't want to answer, but is our life actually bearing the sort of fruit that reflects our Christian identity? Is everybody a perfect Christian?
So what sort of fruit are we looking for, too?
Well, that's, I answered it with another question.
Okay. Not fair.
But am I bringing people to Christ?
Okay, so that's like the home run. I would say that's the home run. But in order to score runs, you can score runs in other ways. And so I think if we start at the fruit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, goodness, and self-control, is your life reflecting those fruits as Paul described them? And if you are, I mean, it would be wonderful if every time we ever said anything to someone about Jesus, they immediately said, I understand, I believe, I will commit my life to Christ. But I don't think that's a realistic expectation. But if we look for in our own lives, are we kinder than we were yesterday or last year? Instead of offering a snarky comment like, well, if you want to do it on Thursday instead of Wednesday, like that. But, you know, and that was just humor. That wasn't a bad thing to say. But, you know, if we return a kind word when someone speaks harshly to us, or we hold our tongue in when we wouldn't have. Now, I think you got to be careful setting such a high expectation that, you know, you're converting people to Jesus, because that's not your job. Your job is to tell people about Jesus and plant the seed. Maybe
well, and that, I mean, that is right. The ultimate goal,
right? It is,
you're right. We do it by planting seeds,
right? And if we're evaluating ourselves, I don't think we should be evaluating ourselves just on are people coming to Jesus because of my message, because we may never know that,
right?
And so we'll always think that we were failures, but we can look at our lives and see how. Are we more bearing more fruit than we did before? Not necessarily the whole thing.
And is that our focus? You know, are we wanting to make sure we're bearing fruit? That we're focusing on Christ's plan? You know, and each of us may have a different plan, but is that the focus? So does anybody share some of the fruit that you've seen in your life? Some of the ways that, you know, you've seen God at work and something good has happened?
I'll share a couple of things. Christy told you earlier, kind of, you know, the first week, why one of the reasons why we're here, but there's just been, I don't know, this whole, there's been a lot of interesting things over the last several weeks because of the fire that we've gone through. But even prior to that, you know, this was a year that we were hoping, Christy and I were hoping to make some significant changes in our lives and in terms of our involvement with our company. And we've been putting a lot of effort and planning into that for really the last 3 years. And so this was all hopefully going to happen, you know, and over the first 6 months of this year. But I kept asking God, there was just something that made me feel uncomfortable that, you know, was I really ready to take this step away from, you know, Jennerjohn Machine? And the thing that was bothering me is I feel like I've led I feel like I've done a good job leading our company and growing our company, but I've regretted that I haven't been. And I think I've made a lot of decisions over the years that were biblically based, but I didn't share. The people who were closest to me from my management team understood that. And they're most of them, well, they all are, but some of them, we can share our faith quite a bit together at work. But from the other 55 employees, you know, that's not something that I made it a point. We would always pray. We would have Thanksgiving meals, Christmas meals, Good Friday meal, just a variety of different meals throughout the year. And our shop foreman would always pray. And I always thought, I mean, for the last 10 years, why aren't I the one that's praying? I should be the one that's praying. I should be that example. Anyway, so the fire hits on the 26th, where on the 9th, we're going to come back. Our plan is to come back to the company and make some announcements. In January, the fire hits on the 26th, and the first thing I thought is that, well, now I know that I can't follow through with my plan because there's a big mess to clean up, and I've got to make sure that the company is going to recover from this, and so I felt it was God somewhat saying, I'm going to give you one more opportunity to stay here for a little bit longer and allow you to maybe give you some opportunity to show you why you make some of those decisions. So anyway, very purposefully, our first visit back, our first meeting as a company back, we talked a lot about, you know, being a family and that during this recovery process, we were going to get ticked off at each other and, you know, but we needed to stay as a family. And then we brought a lot of things about peace into it. And I took a long part of the presentation of, I never panicked when this happened. And because I felt like, I think, you know, one of the biggest values or benefits I feel of being a Christian is that no matter what happens, you're going to be okay. And so I even when I'm flying home, not knowing what I'm going to see when I get to the plant, I just never panicked, you know. And then when I saw it, and saw it, I still never panicked. Anyway, so I had the opportunity to share that with all the employees, and I, because I wanted to bring family into it, I invited them to bring their spouses and stuff to the meetings and so on. Anyway, the amount of encouragement that we have received and you know, from the employees and their appreciation for sharing those Christian views, I don't know, it's just been this question about, you know, are you providing the are you producing the fruit? It's I mean, I feel like I've done that with my church and my friends and my family, but I wasn't purposeful about it with my coworkers. And so anyway, that's a long answer to your question, but it's just interesting how some of that stuff is just as we go through the study, how it hits me personally. So
again, and we all have ways that we need to grow yet. The next question, do our habits and actions just look like my neighbor's friends who claim no faith, you know, or are we really, are we reflecting Jesus, our habits? Anybody got any bad habits? Oh, that's, I mean, no, nobody has.
I don't, but okay. I lie.
So, again, as I showed the this afternoon, so too. So, when we look at the both bearing fruit, our actions, our habits, what we do, It's both individually and as a church and as a denomination, you know, it's the really good church. So did everybody already read John 15, 1 through 8? Let's turn to that. And it's on the screen too. So, somebody else like to read?
It's one of my favorite verses and favorite sections. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up, and they gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples.
But continuing again, it's not, as shared, it's not us that are bringing people to Christ, but we are supposed to do the work of that. When I went on the walk to Emmaus, the message that I heard was, I don't save anybody. The Holy Spirit saves. That was before my call, but it was part of my call. Becoming a pastor doesn't mean that I'm supposed to save anybody. So it's pointing to Jesus. And have Jesus work in me to help lead people, but I don't save them. But again, it's Christ that's doing that work. Now, and then Christ in us, continuing, and as we at Grace shared the first month too, prayer helps continue to get Christ in us that will help us then to do that work. Remember that he continues to have that love, that power, that strength, that wisdom, that allowing him to truly abide in us. So doing good habits helps that process. Praying, reading, being with people, talking, reading out loud, as she shared from Isaiah too, reading the scriptures out loud is often important. I encourage people, especially the Psalms, other things, read them out loud, even to yourself. So you hear it as well as see it and know it, in your brain, all those things. So those are important things too. So again, a great message and connection. And the last, the ones who call evil good, day 3. So is there anybody in church that calls evil good? We all have some time probably, right? We can't point our finger at somebody else, making sure that that's the step too. So,
or we decide something isn't a sin.
Yeah.
And so we hold it up and think, this isn't really a sin.
Yeah. But we know culture-wise too, and especially in the United States, other cultures as well, though there have been many things that continue to change, and it's not a new thing. You can go back in history, what is actually evil, some people call good. So it's not a brand new thing, but it continues to be a problem that people say it's okay. So sharing those kind of things and growing from that. So, shares from Isaiah chapter 5, verse 8. So from 8 to 11.
I can't remember how to get there. Which one did you want?
So Isaiah 5:8.
Maybe I didn't. I don't think I turned the page on that one.
Okay.
Sorry.
All right. Somebody else want to read that? 8-11.
Woe to you who add house to house and join field to field till no space is left and you live alone in the land. The Lord Almighty has declared in my hearing, surely the great houses will become desolate and fine mansions left without occupants. A 10-acre vineyard will produce only a bath of wine, a homer of seed, only an ephah of grain. Woe to those who rise early in the morning to run after their drinks, who stay up late at night till they are inflamed with wine.
All right, so are there anything there that you could be arrested for? So it asks the question, list all the crimes named in this passage, even if you don't understand what they are. Are there crimes there? Easier words to say, are there things that are wrong?
Sounds like drunkenness.
Okay, yep.
It sounds like greed, like you're living all alone, you're taking all the land. That's not the way it was supposed to be.
Yeah. And again, as you read through the scriptures and stuff too, the land was for the families. They weren't supposed to buy more. They weren't supposed to take anybody else's. And again, the promised land was a gift from God, and they were supposed to continue to give that to the next generations, not accumulate more. It wasn't about that. And again, in our culture right now is we should accumulate more, right? And then we're wealthy and happy. And so saying those things are not right. So there's different things there that he's sharing of what we need to make sure we're looking at. Woe to those. You're in trouble. You shouldn't be doing this. Pay attention. You know, look at this. This is wrong. You know, so sharing that. And so as we read scriptures and stuff too, again, making sure we see, is this something I need to learn from? Am I wanting too much land, too much stuff, too much me, too much more for me? Is that how I'm living? You know, and again, the alcohol, well, again, they can drink wine. Wine was no problem, but too much. Are there other things that we do too much of? Again, not just alcohol, but other things that we accumulate too much of or take too much of looking at those kind of things so we can learn from Isaiah's plan as well. So, and then it says in verses 13 and 17 are the consequences. So are there consequences if we don't do what's right?
Yeah.
We don't always find out right away, though. You know, it's not always an immediate thing, but there's always consequences if we don't do what's right, including, you know, God's specific call for us. So it's not just doing the wrong things, it's not doing the right thing. If God has called you to sing and play music, so we've got people that play piano, you know, and you're like, nope, don't want to do that. Not today. Yeah. Whatever the call is that we're supposed to do, and we say no to God, you know, there will be consequences that we'll lose out. We won't have the blessing. If we do what God's calling us to do, then we'll know the blessing. As you, you know, part of that blessing, it will continue on. So. Well, it reminds me of the, and I know I've told this before, but I had been off work for 3 months after having knee surgery or knee replacement. And during that time, I worked in retail, the store started opening on Sunday mornings. And I went in and said, are you going to tell me I have to work Sunday mornings? And, you know, it was like, well, you know, we can maybe work around it. And, of course, others stepped up and volunteered, you know, to cover on the Sunday mornings that I should have worked. But then when the holidays came around, he was like, do you really have to be off every Sunday morning? And I'm like, yes, because I was prepared. If he told me, yes, I had to work Sunday morning, I was prepared to say, okay, I'm giving you my notice, you know. I don't know what I would have done. I wasn't faced with that, but I was prepared. That's what I would have done, and I would have found something else at that point.
Right. Turn to page 38. So again, I think there's lots of good comments and things that are shared too. So our people, our places, and our faith, if someone would read that paragraph.
In our contemporary world, did you say for someone to read it out loud?
Yeah, please. Okay. Yeah.
In our contemporary world, we too often picture our God as some sort of irrelevant Santa Claus figure who has little to say about real life. In this particular passage from Isaiah, we've seen that Yahweh has a lot to say about real life, in particular, how we do business. Our God cares very much about our ethics in business, and he cares very much about the impoverished who are victimized when the wealthy and influential are not careful with their assets. Take a moment to think about how your family uses its money. Are you being careful to allow God to define good in the way you buy and sell, or is someone else's definition of good crowding out his voice?
So, and we're living in a community that has a lot of poverty. We're living in a community where there are a lot of people that don't attend church and opportunities for us to reach out and share. And then if we think about our world, there's a whole lot of, again, we have so much compared to other people. We make so much more money. We have so much more stuff than other countries. And other countries, when they're having these natural disasters, their homes are destroyed because they're not built like ours. I mean, there are different things that have happened recently.
Earthquakes.
Yeah. And they, you know, don't have clean water and food. And so the opportunity we have to share. And so making sure we're doing what's right. So, again, learning from Isaiah, it's not just a one-time thing. It's not just somebody else. It's for us to continue to see how can we make sure that we're doing what's right. And asking God to guide us in that. And God will, as you shared, God will continue to help guide us through all those next steps and to care so much. And the specific things, we all can't do everything, but what does God want us to do? Who does God want us to reach out here in our community? Who does God want us to reach out around the world? What are some of the specific things that we're supposed to do, both individually, as a church, as a denomination, so that we can do God's work. And then we will know the blessing if we bought it. We'll know the consequences if we don't, as Isaiah shares, but we'll know the great blessing when we do. Anything else?
No, I think that was well said. And the whole thing about knowing the blessing or not knowing the blessing is that if we aren't obedient, we may never even know what we didn't have. And, you know, there's so many ways that you can be blessed. And, you know, as a pastor, before a funeral, I go and I talk to the family about it, about the funeral. But really what's happening is they're getting a chance to spend a couple hours remembering that person that they lost and getting a chance to see how they were blessed by that person in their life. And a lot of times we don't think that. We don't think about that. We're so wrapped up in, well, okay, now like we got to go to the funeral home tomorrow and we got to find all the right outfit and all this stuff that's going on. And we don't really have the chance to explore how that the loss of that person is going to affect us, but also how having that person, what a blessing that was in their life to have that person. So, you know, we can miss out on the blessings just because we're in too much of a hurry sometimes.
So, you need a book for next week? Plan on kind of the Lenten studies, you can pick those up, pass those around. So, and Ash Wednesday service is at 6:30 here. You don't have to come, but if you want to, we'll have that, and then we'll have a study at 7. So.
And if you can't come to the 6:30 service and you want to be in position of the Ashes, you can come to the Youth Annex across Cherry Street for grace at 2:30 on February 14th.
So do you want a separate book too?
We're going to be out of town, so
okay.
I don't know. Make
right. Yeah, close this in here.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time together. We thank you for the thoughts that you kindle in our minds through your word. Thank you for your logos. And generally speaking, when we talk about the logos, we're talking about Jesus the Christ, the living logos, where he came into the world to give us a heart of flesh and to take away that heart of stone that was incapable of a relationship with you. Lord, as we approach the Lenten season, we'd ask that you would open our eyes once again to see Christ at work in our own lives, to see how you continue to bless us, and to see the hope and promise that we have. And we also thank you for the opportunity to work within your kingdom, to be a blessing to others, to bear fruit as we help each other, bear fruit as we help those who don't know you at all. Lord, as we go forth from this place, I'd ask that you would surround us all with your protection for traveling mercies, that you would keep us safe as we continue to strive to do your will. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.